Hey, what's up, everybody? It is Dante Fortson here. Today we're going to be talking about the Great Awakening, but more importantly, the Fifth Great Awakening. And I'm going to tell you guys why I call it that soon. Now, some people will say, well, this awakening is not of God. Why? Because they can't understand it. Why? Because God is in their tiny little box. And God isn't allowed to do anything that they say he's not allowed to do. Or if they don't understand it, it must certainly mean that God can't move outside of their understanding. And so I'm going to attempt to show you guys some, I'm going to show you guys some hypocrisy in them saying that, well, the awakening is not of God. The awakening is falling away when it's black people. But when Europeans were having their awakenings, we didn't hear any of this kind of talk, especially from people who call themselves believers from our own community, from the black community. And so we're going to talk about that today. But before we get to that, make sure you guys hit the thumbs up if you haven't done so already. Please hit the subscribe button if you haven't done so already and click the notification bell as well. Last and certainly not least, please share this video. So if you guys have heard of the Great Awakening before, please press 1 in the chat. If you have not, please press 2. All right, and if you guys want to do some extra research into Israel, its connection to the Bible, Israel's connection to some black people today. I don't believe every black person on the planet is Israel. But if you guys want to do some research into the subject, come on over to blackhistoryinthebible.com. As you can see, there's a ton of research that has been collected and is going to continue to be collected and added to the site. So check out blackhistoryinthebible.com for all your Black History in the Bible research needs. All right. Lastly, this study is brought to you by undeniable full-color evidence of black Israelites in the Bible. As you guys can see, it has 1,079 reviews. It is ranked 4.8 out of 5 stars. So you guys can pick that up on Amazon.com or Barnes & Noble or any of your digital retailers. All right, so we're going to jump into this. Let's talk about the Great Awakening. First thing I'm going to do is go to History Channel, even though History Channel is not the most reliable source for history, ironically. But we're going to look at several sources today, and we're just going to talk about the Great Awakening. We're getting into an overview. We're not digging in depth into the European awakenings. But I just want to show you guys the difference in treatment when it comes to us black people saying, hey, there's an awakening. And when Europeans were saying that they were having an awakening, and I've never heard the black church specifically criticize the European awakenings. So this is definitely, in my opinion, a race issue. And I've been saying that for a long time. The difference here is the skin color. And that is the only difference. Why? Because many people in the church teach what is being called a skin doctrine. They believe all black people are automatically Hamites based solely on skin color. That's why when we say that we're Israel, they immediately say, no, you're not. Well, how do you know I'm not? If you don't know me personally, you don't know my DNA, you don't know my history, you don't know anything about me, you have to be basing it 100% on skin color. And anyone that's telling you they don't base that on skin color is lying. So let's talk about this. The Great Awakening. The Great Awakening was a religious revival that impacted the English colonies in America during the 1730s and 1740s. The movement came at a time when the idea of secular rationalism was being emphasized and passion for religion had grown stale. Christian leaders often traveled from town to town, preaching about the gospel, emphasizing salvation from sins, and promoting enthusiasm for Christianity. The result was a renewed dedication toward religion. Many historians believe the Great Awakening had a lasting impact on various Christian denominations and American culture at large. Maybe they're concerned that this awakening is going to have a lasting impact on Christian denominations and American culture at large. And we know it has. We know people have been leaving churches. They want to try to say people are leaving churches because of us Israelites, but that's not true. Many people were being called out of the church long before that. And when I use the term church, just so there's no confusion, I'm talking about the building, not the body of Christ. The building that people go and sit in, the building that houses the circuses in some circumstances, not every church. So a lot of people were called out of the building a long time before they, you know, even entered into research, or you know, however they came to believe that they were Israel. Some people came by dreams, some people came by visions, some people came by mystical experiences, some people came in looking at the DNA, some people were praying, some people like myself looked at the history, and that's how we came into the truth. People are coming all different kind of ways. So let me see if there was any part I highlighted on here specifically. Oh yeah, okay. So we're gonna read this first paragraph, or these first right here, and then we're gonna jump down to the second and third great awakenings, and we're gonna read about those. And then I'm gonna tell you why I call this the fifth great awakening as we proceed through here. All right, the first great awakening. In the 1700s, a European philosophical movement known as the Enlightenment, or the Age of Reason, was making its way across the Atlantic Ocean to the American colonies. Enlightenment thinkers emphasized a scientific and logical view of the world while downplaying religion. And for those of you familiar with the Illuminati and Adam Weishaupt, Adam Weishaupt, who founded the Illuminati, he's going to come out of this Enlightenment period where they're pushing science and a logical view of the world and downplaying religion. And their goal is to infiltrate schools and the higher up learnings, not celebrities, nothing like that. These were scientists, not musicians, and, you know, all the stuff that has gotten out of control today with the half-baked accusations against celebrities. And I tell people to be careful with that. Don't falsely accuse somebody because you think you saw something on stage. In marketing, and again, I tell you guys all the time, I have a marketing background. In marketing, when something is popular, they press that button because they get free promotion. Imagine any other, just imagine the ability to get millions of dollars in free promotion simply by making a hand gesture. Do you think their marketing team is going to tell them to do it? Of course. That doesn't prove that they're in the Illuminati or anything else. A lot of times the artist may not even know what they're doing, in all honesty, because their marketing team has come with them and say, hey, this right here is popular on the internet. You do it, you're going to go viral. You're going to sell a lot of albums. You're going to make a lot of money. And that's just the facts. Some people don't want to believe it, but that's just the facts of how it goes. So let me read the next paragraph. In many ways, religion has, let me start over. In many ways, religion was becoming more formal and less personal during this time, which led to lower church attendance. So the awakening is happening and church attendance is, well, let me back up. The Enlightenment was happening and church attendance got lower. So then here comes another awakening, or here comes the first awakening. Christians were feeling complacent with their methods of worship, and some were disillusioned with how wealth and rationalism were dominating culture. Many began to crave a return to religious piety. I encourage you to look at that word, piety. Around this time, the 13 colonies were religiously divided. Most of New England belonged to congregational churches. And remember, we're talking about a time during slavery. The middle colonies were made up of Quakers, Anglicans, Lutherans, Baptists, Presbyterians, the Dutch Reformed, and Congregational followers. Southern colonies were mostly members of the Anglican Church, but there were also many Baptists, Presbyterians, and Quakers. The stage was set for a renewal of faith, and in the late 1720s, a revival began to take root as preachers altered their messages and re-emphasized concepts of Calvinism. Calvinism is a theology that was introduced by John Calvin in the 16th century that stressed the importance of scripture, faith, predestination, and the grace of God. So we're not going to read about Jonathan Edwards, but keep that name in mind. We'll come back to Edwards. George Whitefield, keep that name in mind. The basic themes of the Great Awakening. The Great Awakening brought various philosophies, ideas, and doctrines to the forefront of Christian faith. Some of the major themes included: all people are born sinners. Sin without salvation will send a person to hell. All people can be saved if they confess their sins to God, seek forgiveness, and accept God's grace. All people can have a direct and emotional connection with God. Let me stop right there, because we have heard a lot about emotionalism. So how is it back then these Europeans were saying, hey, you can have an emotional connection with God. Emotionalism wasn't a problem. But now people are saying that emotionalism is a problem, even though we find emotionalism all throughout the Bible. God tells people he's going to kill them if they don't obey. He's going to send them into slavery. Their kids would go into slavery. Their wives would be raped. They would be beat. They would be hunted down. This causes emotional reactions because this is what happened in slavery. So the very thing that God told Israel would happen, happened. And when we talk about it, people say we're using emotionalism. And I'm not sure how you avoid emotionalism when you're talking about a brutal history of a people. And we don't hear this. When we hear people talk about the Holocaust, they don't ever use the word emotionalism. When we hear people talk about 9/11 and other major atrocities, they don't ever use the word emotionalism. They only use that towards black people. It's a cult tactic to get black people to shut up about things that they don't want to hear. Or maybe they don't want the Most High to hear it. I don't know. Religion shouldn't be formal and institutionalized, but rather casual and personal. So if you compare the first Great Awakening to the awakening that's happening now, it's a rebellion against institutionalized religion. The problem many people have is with the church building, not the church body. And there is a difference, even though people are trying to tie those together as if when you leave the building, you have left the body of Christ. If you leave the building, you have left the assembly. And that's simply not true, because the Bible says where two or three are gathered together in his name, there he is in the midst of them. Meaning, just because you leave the body does not mean you're forsaking the assembly. You may be forsaking assembling with that group of people, but nowhere in the Bible does it say you have to assemble with the same group of people every single Sabbath or every single Sunday. And I'm not against Sunday worship either. Some of y'all may be surprised by that. Some of y'all already know that. So these cult tactics are used, even though the first Great Awakening, again, the European Great Awakening, is very similar to the Israelite, what we Israelites call the awakening right now, in that one specific regard. We also, again, all people are born sinners. I haven't met an Israelite yet that doesn't believe that we were all born sinners. Some believe that they can obtain salvation by the law, and some believe that we must repent and turn to Christ. All right, and the next point, sin without salvation will send a person to hell. I believe we all agree with that, whether it be Christian or Israelite. Sin without salvation will send a person to hell. All people can be saved if they confess their sins to God, seek forgiveness, and accept God's grace. Now, I personally believe in salvation by grace through faith. You have people in the Christian church and you have Israelites who do not believe that. And then all people can have a direct and emotional connection with God. So, again, there are people on both sides that believe that and people on both sides that do not believe that. So we see similarities between the first Great Awakening and what's happening right now. So a little bit about the second Great Awakening. The Great Awakening came to an end sometime during the 1740s. In the 1790s, another religious revival, which became known as the Second Great Awakening, began in New England. This movement is typically regarded as less emotionally charged than the First Great Awakening. It led to the founding of several colleges, seminaries, and mission societies. So now we're going to start to see the seminaries pop up toward the 1800s as we're heading toward the abolition of slavery. Not quite yet. A third Great Awakening was said to span from the late 1850s to the early 20th century. Some scholars, however, disagree that this movement was ever a significant event. And real quick, we'll read the effects of the Great Awakening, because we get a good overview. And then once we go through the other sources, we'll just touch on certain things. All right. The Great Awakening notably altered the religious climate in the American colonies. Ordinary people were encouraged to make a personal connection with God instead of relying on a minister. Does that not sound similar to what's happening right now? Newer denominations such as Methodist and Baptist grew quickly, while the movement unified the colonies and boosted church growth. Experts say it also caused division among those who supported it and those who rejected it. Interesting. Mark those that caused division, right? Many historians claim that the Great Awakening influenced the Revolutionary War by encouraging the notions of nationalism and individual rights. The revival also led to the establishment of several renowned educational institutions, including Princeton, Rutgers, Brown, and Dartmouth universities. The Great Awakening unquestionably had a significant impact on Christianity. It reinvigorated religion in America at a time when it was steadily declining and introduced ideas that would penetrate into American culture for many years to come. All right, so now we got a brief overview of the first through third awakenings. So now if we go to Wikipedia real quick, we're only going to read this first section right here just to kind of touch on it. And then we'll... You got the first Great Awakening, second Great Awakening, third, and we'll jump down to the fourth since the other one did not mention anything on the fourth. So we'll read this quick summary and jump down to the fourth, and that'll explain why I call this the fifth Great Awakening. It's different. It has some similarities to the others, but it's different in the fact that this one is being led by people who define themselves as Israelites, who were formerly defined as African American, Black, or Negro, but the descendants of slaves. And it's not just in America, it's all over the world. The Great Awakening refers to a number of periods of religious revival in American Christian history. Historians and theologians identify three, or sometimes four, waves of increased religious enthusiasm between the early 18th century and late 20th century. Each of these Great Awakenings was characterized by widespread revivals led by evangelical Protestant ministers, a sharp increase of interest in religion, a profound sense of conviction and redemption on the part of those affected, an increase in evangelical church membership, and the formation of new religious movements and denominations. So new things happened during the awakening. And again, a lot in common with what's going on now, except for the one being led now is being led by people who refer to themselves as Israelites and not European Christians. And when I say European Christians, I literally mean European Christians were leading these awakenings. These were not slaves leading these awakenings. So here, the fourth Great Awakening right here is a debated concept that has not received the acceptance of the first three. Advocates such as economist Robert Fogel say it happened in the late 1960s and early 70s. That's basically the civil rights era. The Jesus movement is one evidence of this awakening, and it created a shift in church music styles. Mainline Protestant denominations weakened sharply in both membership and influence, while most conservative religious denominations such as the Southern Baptist and Missouri Synod Lutherans grew rapidly in numbers, spread across the United States, had grave internal theological battles and schisms, and became politically powerful. So now we see we have information about the first through fourth Great Awakenings, all led by Europeans, all led by the Christian church. But because this one is not spearheaded by the Christian church, suddenly this is not of God. So right here, terminology. The idea of an awakening implies a slumber or passivity during secular or less religious times. Awakening is a term which originates from and is embraced often and primarily by evangelical Christians. In recent times, the idea of awakenings in the United States history has been put forth by conservative American evangelicals. So this awakening is a Christian term. And yet that's not what we're presented with when the opposition talks about the awakening of Israel. They don't put it in context of that. They act like we came up with the term the awakening. Now, I want to show you guys some pictures real quick. Let me check Google to see if they have some, but I want to show you guys some pictures. All right, so we're going to jump over here to some of the images and how the awakening was presented or depicted. We see a preacher and we see a crowd of Europeans listening to that preacher. And here we go. We see this again. The Great Awakening and American Revolution, Journal of the American Revolution. This was from history.com, The Great Awakening. We see this over here, The Great Awakening, Facts and History. So we see this idea of the awakening by Europeans. Again, this was before the invention of the camera, so there's no actual pictures But we see this idea of crowds crowded around these preachers. I don't see these people in churches, though. That's interesting. They're not in the church buildings. But anyway, I'm not going to get stuck on the pictures. So let's keep going. The Great Awakening. We're going to read this highlighted part right here. George Whitfield. I told you to keep some of these names in mind. We'll come back over here real quick. Told you to keep George Whitfield. Told you to keep some of these names in mind. George Whitfield was a minister from Britain who toured the American colonies. An actor by training, he would shout the word of God, weep with sorrow, and tremble with passion as he delivered his sermons. Colonists flocked by the thousands to hear him speak. He converted slaves and even a few Native Americans. Even religious skeptic Benjamin Franklin emptied his coin purse after hearing him speak in Philadelphia. Soon, much of America became divided. Awakening or New Light preachers set up their own schools and churches throughout the colonies. Princeton University was one such school. So again, Princeton University was mentioned. So Princeton University came out of a previous awakening. And yet we don't hear them condemned like we are condemned. The old light ministers refused to accept the new style of worship. Despite the conflict, one surprising result was greater religious toleration. With so many new denominations, it was clear that no one religion would dominate any region. So we had a whole shift in religious paradigm. Right here, we'll read this last paragraph, and you see the pictures right here, just similar to what I showed you. Although the Great Awakening was a reaction against the Enlightenment, we read about that. The Enlightenment is what led to the establishment of the Illuminati, Illumination, Enlightenment. Although the Great Awakening was a reaction against the Enlightenment, it was also a long-term cause of the Revolution. Before, ministers represented an upper class of sorts. Awakening ministers were not always ordained, breaking down respect for betters. The new faiths that emerged were much more democratic in their approach. The overall message was one of greater equality. The Great Awakening was also a national occurrence. It was the first major event that all the colonies could share, helping to break down differences between them. There was no such episode in England, further highlighting variances between Americans and their cousins across the sea. Indeed, this religious upheaval had marked political consequences. So right now we're hearing similarities. So if you hear, see, or get the similarities that are being talked about between the previous European awakenings and the one that is happening now, please press 1 in the chat. If you don't see any similarities at all, press 2. Be honest. Press 1 if you see the similarities. Press 2 if you do not. We're going to get into some scripture as to why we believe that an awakening is occurring among Israelites. Let me turn this off. Britannica. Let me see. Did I highlight anything on here? There we go. Now, we're gonna do a little bit of reading because I think some of this is interesting. They all fill in little gaps that other ones don't have. So, Great Awakening. Religious revivals in the British American colonies, mainly between about 1720 and the 1740s, it was part of the religious ferment that swept Western Europe in the latter part of the 17th and early 18th century. Referred to as Pietism and Quietism in continental Europe among Protestants and Roman Catholics, and as Evangelicalism in England under the leadership of John Wesley. The Puritan fervor of the American colonies waned toward the end of the 17th century, but the Great Awakening under the leadership of Jonathan Edwards, George Whitfield, the names keep coming up, and others, served to revitalize religion in the region. All right. Let's see. The Great Awakening represented a reaction against the increasing secularization of society and against the corporate and materialistic nature of the principal churches of American society. A number of conditions in the colonies contributed to the revival: an arid rationalism in New England, formalism in liturgical practices as among the Dutch Reformed in the middle colonies, and the neglect of pastoral supervision in the South. Neglect, huh? The revival took place primarily among the Dutch Reformed Congregationalists, Presbyterians, Baptists, and some Anglicans, almost all of whom were Calvinists. Now remember what the other source said, these people were not always ordained. By making conversion the initial step, on the road of salvation, and by opening the conversion experience to all who recognize their own sinfulness, the ministers of the Great Awakening, some intentionally and others unwittingly, democratized Calvinist theology. The Great Awakening has been seen, therefore, as a development towards an evangelical Calvinism. Indeed, the evangelical styles of religious worship promoted by the revival helped make the religious doctrines of many of the insurgent church denominations, particularly those of the Baptists and the Methodists, more accessible to a wider cross-section of the American population. And then I'm going to read this part, and then we're going to move on. The revival preachers emphasized the terrors of the law. That's the first five books of Moses. The revival preachers emphasized the terrors of the law to sinners, the unmerited grace of God, and the new birth in Jesus Christ. Didn't we see a minute ago they were also called new birth preachers? They frequently sought to inspire in their listeners a fear of the consequences of their sinful lives and a respect for the omnipotence of God. This sense of the ferocity of God was often tempered by the implied promise that a rejection of worldliness and a return to faith would result in a return to grace and an avoidance of the horrible punishments of an angry God. Tell me that doesn't sound like what's going on right now among Israelites, trying to tell them, hey, we need to turn back because of disobedience. This is why we're in this situation, because of disobedience, and we need to turn back. They emphasize the terrors of the law. We're not making this stuff up out of thin air. We just see the reaction is different because of skin color. It has nothing to do with anything else other than skin color. And remember, we just read that not a lot of these people were ordained. Same situation we have now. A lot of these people out here preaching are not ordained. If we read through the Bible, we don't see anybody that is ordained by a seminary or church institution. Let's keep going. There was a certain contradictory quality about the Great Awakening theology, however, predestination. One of the principal tenets of Calvinism theology of most of the ministers of the Great Awakening was ultimately incompatible with the promise that humans could, by a voluntary act of faith, achieve salvation by their own efforts. I think that's worded differently. If we're just going to be honest, I think that's worded incorrectly. When people have faith in Christ, they're not achieving salvation by their own efforts. So I don't agree with Britannica right there. I don't even believe that represents the proper Christian position. So if we're just going to be honest, we got to be honest about the whole thing. I don't know of any Christians that believe that salvation by grace through faith is considered your own effort. So the wording there to me is misleading. But nevertheless, it's incompatible because Calvinists believe in predestination, that you're already determined whether you're saved or not. But this right here, awakening, led to evangelical Calvinism, which is why you have Calvinists who believe in predestination, but they will also preach the gospel while they still believe that either you're already saved or not, regardless of whether you accept Christ, regardless of what you do, you've already been chosen for hell or for glory. And so it becomes contradictory. And this is why there's a problem to me in what's going on with some of the stuff we see with the opposition. They hold two inconsistent ideologies at one time, preach the gospel, but the outcome has already been determined. These are two inconsistent ideologies. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So anyway, let's keep going. So again, press one if you see some of, if you're seeing the similarities still, press one. If you're not seeing the similarities yet, please press two. Because we know many of them like to call this Israelite doctrine. They like to call this an Israelite movement. But as we're seeing, it matches a lot with what the Europeans were doing. We're just not European. So now I'm going to read these two sections right here that I have highlighted. This is from TeacherServe. I'll get all these links to these articles in the description for you guys, so you guys can click them and read through the whole thing yourself. So here we go. Divining America, religion in American history. What historians call the First Great Awakening can best be described as a revitalization of religious piety that swept through the American colonies between the 1730s and the 1770s. So we're seeing kind of different dates. We see 1720s all the way to 1740s, and then we see 1750s. So they're kind of combining it all together, even though they started to Excuse me, I get hiccups every time I get on here, even though they're starting at the 1730s. That revival was part of a much broader movement, an evangelical upsurge taking place simultaneously on the other side of the Atlantic, most notably in England, Scotland, and Germany. In all these Protestant cultures during the middle decades of the 18th century, a new age of faith rose to counter the current tenets of the Age of Enlightenment, to reaffirm the view that being truly religious meant trusting the heart rather than the head, prizing feeling more than thinking, emotionalism, and relying on biblical revelation rather than human reason. Does this not sound like what's going on? People are saying that they had visions and they're relying on the Holy Spirit and biblical revelation rather than seminary theology, rather than the established church doctrine. Press one if you with me. The earliest manifestations of the American phase of this phenomenon, the beginnings of the first Great Awakening, appeared among Presbyterians in Pennsylvania and New Jersey. So now we're getting more information. Led by the Tennant family, Reverend William Tennant, a Scots-Irish immigrant, and his four sons, all clergymen, the Presbyterians not only initiated religious revivals in those colonies during the 1730s, but also established a seminary to train clergymen whose fervent, heartfelt preaching would bring sinners to experience evangelical conversion. Originally known as the Law College, it is better known today as Princeton University. So wait, Princeton University was established to train clergymen whose fervent, heartfelt preaching or emotionalism would bring sinners to experience evangelical conversion. So they were using emotionalism to convert people. And yet today we hear emotionalism talked about as if it's a bad thing. Why don't we ever hear churches speaking out against what was happening during these four great awakenings in the Christian church in early American and early, technically late European history? We just don't hear it. We don't get in-depth teaching about these awakenings. Why? Because they want to demonize what we Israelites are doing. So let's keep going. What was the Great Awakening? Know the facts and summary. Did I highlight anything here? Here we go. Origins of the Great Awakening, and then we're going to get into some biblical reasons why we Israelites believe that there is an awakening going on right now in the body of black believers specifically. This is, and there are some non-black believers awakening to the fact that we are Israel. This is not 100% black. I'd say it's about 95% happening in the black community, if we're being honest. All right, here we go. The event that has become known as the Great Awakening actually began years earlier in the 1720s. So we see this consistent time frame. And although the most significant years were from 1740 to 1742, so a two-year period, the revival continued until the 1760s. Many of the early colonists had come to the New World to enjoy religious freedom, but as the land became tamed and prosperous, they no longer relied on God for their daily bread. Wealth brought complacency towards God. As a result, church membership dropped. Sound like what's happening now? It just in general, not even just with the awakening. Wishing to make it easier to increase church attendance, the religious leaders had instituted the halfway covenant, which allowed membership without a public testimony of conversion. Interesting. The churches were now attended largely by people who lacked a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So you mean they started inviting in everybody? Sadly, many of the ministers themselves did not know Christ and therefore could not lead their flocks to the true shepherd. This is from Christianity.com. And I believe the same thing. If you don't know Christ yourself, how can you lead someone to a savior you don't know personally? Then suddenly the Spirit of God awoke as though from an intense slumber and began to touch the population of the colonies. People from all walks of life, from poor farmers to rich merchants, begin experiencing renewal and rebirth. Oh, wait, they suddenly wanted to start following God, the Bible, Christ. The Spirit of God awoke as though from an intense slumber. This is the same thing that many Israelites are talking about is going on in our communities. Again, some people are coming through DNA. Some people are coming through the history. Some people are coming through dreams and visions. Many of us were very active in the Christian church And I'm talking about the building, not the body. We're still active in the body, but I'm talking about in the building. They want to deny that, and many people want to, you know, create these false scenarios. But at the end of the day, if anybody takes anybody's story and says, well, you weren't really a believer, they're lying, because they can't say that. They can't say you weren't really a believer because you're black and you say you're Israel. My ethnic claim has nothing to do with my faith in Christ, period. It has nothing to do with my faith in Christ. I had my faith in Christ before I started calling myself an Israelite. They want to act like we can't be Israel and be saved at the same time. And if that's the case, it's true for Jews, for Jesus as well. They cannot be Jewish and saved if we cannot be Israelite and saved. And that's just the facts. Somebody can't be Irish or Italian or any of their other ethnicities and be saved if Israelites can't be Israelite and saved. So now let's start talking about this concept of an awakening, which we get from scripture, and why many of us, not all of us, I don't speak for all Israelites, but why many of us believe that or believe that something is happening now, and why we call this an awakening. All right, we're going to start here in Deuteronomy, and we're just going to look at some verses, and I'm just going to point out some things as to why we call this the awakening. And as you guys notice, a lot of the Bible study keeps leading us right back to the book of Deuteronomy. A lot of these studies, this is why we're up to Deuteronomy, beyond Deuteronomy 28. What is this? Part 13. This is part 13, the fifth great awakening. And we're going to Deuteronomy again. I said this last time. You cannot understand scripture. You cannot understand prophecy in scripture specifically without understanding the Old Testament, but more specifically, the book of Deuteronomy. It's going to come up over and over again. So Deuteronomy chapter 6, we're going to read verses 6 through 15, or sorry, 12 through 15. I'm sorry, chapter 6, verses 12 through 15. Then beware, lest thou forget the Lord, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him and shall swear by his name. Ye shall not go after other gods of the people which are round about you. It doesn't tell you to recontextualize it. It doesn't tell you to repurpose it. It doesn't tell you to take their practices and slap a Jesus bumper sticker on it. It says, ye shall not go after other gods of the gods of the people which are round about you. For the Lord thy God is a jealous God among you, lest the anger of the Lord thy God be kindled against thee and destroy thee from off the face of the earth. So now, God is saying don't go after these other gods, but the point here that I want to point to, then beware lest thou forget the Lord. So there's a reference of people being able to forget the Lord. This is going to be important because we're going to come back to this. Or we're going to, yeah, we'll round right back to it. If we go over to Deuteronomy chapter 8, something similar. Beware that thou forget. This is verse 11. Let's start at verse 10 and we'll read through. Wow, that's a long sentence. We'll read verse 10 through 17. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he hath given thee. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes which I command thee this day. Lest when thou hast eaten and art full and hast built goodly houses and dwelt therein, and when thy herds and thy flocks multiply and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thy heart be lifted up and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, who led thee through the great and terrible wilderness wherein were fiery serpents and scorpions and drought where there was no water, who brought thee forth water out of a rock of flint, who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy fathers knew not, that he might humble thee and that he might prove thee to do thee good at thy latter end. And thou say in thine heart, my power and my might. Let me say this again. And thou say in thine heart, my power and the might of mine hand hath gotten me this wealth. Don't forget about God because of riches and wealth and fullness and comfortability. Remember what God has done for you. Don't forget God. Why would Deuteronomy keep talking about this forgetting if it was not possible to forget. All right, let's move on. So there's this theme of forgetting so far. Three verses. This is Deuteronomy 30. This is in reference to them breaking the contract that we see in Deuteronomy 28. Again, this is why this series is called Beyond Deuteronomy 28, because a lot of things are going to refer back to that covenant made in Deuteronomy 28. And it shall come to pass. It shall come to pass. Not might, not could, not possibly. It shall come to pass when all these things are come upon thee, the blessing and the curse which I have set before thee, that thou shalt call them to mind or remember them among all the nations whither the Lord thy God hath driven thee. And thou shalt return unto the Lord thy God and shall obey his voice according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children with all thy heart, with all thy soul. Let me make sure that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have compassion upon thee and will return and gather thee from all the nations whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. So there's this prophecy. This is prophecy. It's saying you're going to call them to mind among the nations. Israel had not been scattered yet. This is fresh out of Egypt, which means this is prophecy, which means they were going to break these, break this covenant in the future. But the fact is, they would call them to mind among the nations, meaning they would forget them, because in order to have to call something to mind, you have to say, oh yeah, that was supposed to happen. But it has to be called to mind among those nations. So let's keep going. That's Deuteronomy 30. I'm not going to hold y'all long today. We're going to Deuteronomy 32, verses 24 through 27. They shall be burnt with hunger and devoured with burning heat and with bitter destruction. I will also send the teeth of beast upon them with the poison of serpents of the dust. The sword without, we saw that in Deuteronomy 28, and terror within shall destroy both the young man and the virgin, the suckling also with the man of gray hairs. So old to young, that's part of Deuteronomy 28. I said I would scatter them into the corners. I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. God isn't going to wipe out Israel. He's going to make the memory of Israel to cease from among men. If you guys caught my previous studies, I pointed out where it says they are black and they are not known in the streets. And I showed you the Cochin source where it said that they couldn't even tell some of the black Jews from the Hindus. So they would walk past them in the streets and have no idea who they were. I said I would scatter them into the corners. I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. Were it not that I feared the wrath of the enemy, lest their adversaries should behave themselves strangely, and lest they should say, our hand is high, and the Lord have not done all this. When God talks about when he fears the wrath of the enemy, he's not talking about fear like a human feels fear. He's saying, I'm cautious of that because the enemy will come through and say that they did this and not God. Because remember, they have to go back and ask, why is this happening to us? And people have to respond because you have forsaken God and served other gods. You didn't keep his commandment. You broke the covenant. We've gone over all this. And if you guys haven't seen it, go watch Beyond Deuteronomy parts 1 through 12. I'm telling y'all, this is probably the most in-depth study on Deuteronomy 28 and the surrounding prophecies that's out right now. If you guys agree, now I may be wrong, if you guys agree that this is one of the most in-depth studies on Deuteronomy and its importance in end time prophecy, press a 1. If you disagree, press a 2, please. All right, so now we see that God is going to make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. This is important for biblical consistency. So now let's take a look in the Strong's. Right here, if we just glance at the Strong's without even diving deep into it, let me read this one more time. Deuteronomy 32:26. Let me make sure we got the right verse. Okay. I said I would scatter them into the corners and I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. Right here, I said I would dash them in pieces and I would make the memory of them to cease from among men. Hebrew isn't always in the order like the English. You guys will get used to that as you look into the Strong's and other sources. You will see that when you get into Hebrew, it's read from right to left, not left to right. And it doesn't also, the way English, it's hard to explain, the way English words appear in order to us The rest of the world doesn't always speak that way. So you got to kind of get used to reading it how they would read it on the other side of the world where they come from. Languages that read from right to left, and thoughts are more or sentences are more ideas or thoughts than literal, straightforward, how we have exclamatory, declaration, imperative, interrogative, all that stuff. There's a little bit different. So anyway, he will make the memory of them to cease from among men. So let's look at this word real quick. We're going to see how it's interpreted in other parts of the Bible. Memory. Let's go back. So remembrance or memorial. Memorial, remembrance, memory, remembrance, memory, memorial, so on and so forth. We see this all the way down. So he's going to make the remembrance or the memory of Israel cease from among men. They would forget who Israel is. Why are they forgetting who Israel is? Israel wouldn't be destroyed, but he would make their memory to cease. And so when their memory ceases, there has to be something that jogs that memory. That is what we call the awakening, the memory returning to Israel. All right, so let's keep going so we don't be here all night. 1 Kings 8:47. Now, this one is interesting because of the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. Now, the wording is going to be similar between 1 Kings 8:47 and 2 Chronicles, but it's just slightly different. Very similar, but slightly different. People say that, you know, Kings and Chronicles are copies of each other, but there are slightly different wordings. And let's see. We're going to talk about this real quick because this is Solomon's prayer. And this is Solomon's prayer before Israel. I'm not going to read this whole thing. I encourage you guys to read 1 Kings chapter 8 if you have not read it in its entirety. It's very, very revealing in lots of ways. But we'll read this right here. Let me see. We'll read 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 44. We'll go to, 52. So we'll read those 8 verses, 44 to 52. I think 9 verses. If thy people go out to battle against their enemies, whithersoever thou shalt send them, and shall pray unto the Lord toward the city which thou hast chosen, and toward the house that I have built for thy name, then hear thou in heaven their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause. We've gone over this before. If they sin against thee, for there is no man that sinneth not, and thou be angry with them, and deliver them to the enemy, so that they carry them away captives unto the land of the enemy, far or near. Yet if they shall bethink themselves, I missed that why. Yet if they shall bethink themselves in the land whither they are carried captives, and repent, sounds like Deuteronomy, and make supplication unto thee in the land of them that carried them captives, saying, we have sinned and have done perversely, we have committed wickedness, and so return unto thee with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their enemies, not in their own land. Some people will say all these curses had to happen in the land. That's a lie. It's only occurs twice in Deuteronomy 28, and both are in relation to the blessings. So now we see, and with all their soul in the land of their enemies, which led them away captive, and pray unto thee toward their land, which thou gavest unto their fathers, the city which thou hast chosen, and the house which I have built for thy name, then hear thou their prayer and their supplication in heaven thy dwelling place, and maintain their cause. And forgive thy people that have sinned against thee, and all their transgressions wherein they have transgressed against thee. And give them compassion before them who carried them captive, that they may have compassion on them. For they be thy people, and thine inheritance which thou broughtest forth out of Egypt from the midst of the furnace of iron, that thine eyes may be open unto the supplication of thy servant, unto the supplication of thy people Israel, to hearken unto them in all that they call for unto thee. So Solomon is praying for God to listen to Israel in the land of their enemies if they turn and repent. But right here, yet if they shall bethink themselves in the land whither they were carried captives. So this word bethink, shout out to Plummer. He came in one day on another channel, and he pointed out this bethinking part. So right here, if you Google the word bethink, definition of bethink, to think on, reflection, come to think. What does bethinking mean? To remember, to recall, to cause oneself to be reminded, to cause oneself to consider. This is from the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, Merriam-Webster.com. So now, yet if they shall bethink themselves, or yet if they shall remember themselves, or recall themselves, or cause themselves to be reminded. Let me go back. In the land where they were carried away captives. People will say, well, what part of the Bible says you remember your ethnicity? Well, it says Israel will forget their God. God was going to make the remembrance or memory of Israel to cease from among men. And now we hear in King Solomon praying in the First Kings chapter 8, Solomon is praying to the Most High that if Israel bethinks or remembers themselves in the land where they're carried away captives. And nobody can deny that the descendants of slaves, many are still living in the land where our ancestors were carried away captive. This is historical fact. And this is, again, part of the reason we refer to this awakening. There is scriptural evidence for it. But let's keep going. Second Chronicles, I mentioned that has similar wording. This, again, is Solomon's prayer. Then hear thou from the heavens. This is Second Chronicles chapter 6, verse 35 through 39. Then hear thou from heavens their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause. If they sin against thee, for there is no man which sinneth not, and thou be angry with them, and deliver them over before their enemies, and carry them away captives unto a land far off or near, yet if they bethink themselves in the land whither they are carried captive, and turn and pray unto thee in the land of their captivity, saying, we have sinned, we have done amiss, and have dealt wickedly. I would encourage you guys to go do a comparison between this verse here in Second Chronicles and this verse here in First Kings. There are slight differences. And turn away and pray unto thee. Let's see. Yet if they bethink themselves in the land whither they are carried captive, and turn and pray unto thee in the land of their captivity, saying, we have sinned, we have done amiss, and have dealt wickedly. If they return unto thee, or if they return to thee with all their heart and with all their soul in the land of their captivity, whither they have carried them captives, and pray toward their land which thou gavest unto their fathers, and toward the city which thou hast chosen, and toward the house which I have built for thy name, then hear thou from the heavens, even from thy dwelling place, their prayer and their supplications, and maintain their cause, and forgive thy people which have sinned against thee. Where is this coming from? Where's that? Deuteronomy chapter 30. And it shall come to pass, when all these things are come upon thee, the blessings and the curse which I have set before thee, and thou shalt call them to mind among the nations, whither the Lord God hath driven thee, and shall return to the Lord thy God, and shall obey his voice, to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children, with all thy heart and with all thy soul, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity. There are promises. Even after Israel breaks the covenant, God says, if you turn back, I will still perform the things that I promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the other things that I promised to you in the covenant in Deuteronomy 28, the Moab covenant. Everything leads back to Deuteronomy eventually. And have compassion upon thee, and will gather thee from all nations whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. So this is what Solomon is basing his prayer on. Those promises made in Deuteronomy 38, when they mess up the covenant from Deuteronomy 28, God has promises for them. So when people say, well, Israel messed up, they're boasting against the natural branches. Israel had to mess up so that everybody else could come into the covenant of salvation through Christ. Otherwise, they would have had to, sojourn among Israel and practice the law. This is how it was in the Old Testament. Let's go to Jeremiah. So he uses, let me point this out. Second Chronicles, again, uses the word bethink, or as we pointed out, to remember or recall. So if they remember themselves, bethink themselves. Yet if they shall bethink themselves, remember themselves in the land whither they are carried away captives. If they shall remember themselves or bethink themselves. And I know some people are saying, well, that's taken out of context. That doesn't mean that. We're going to see, because there's another straightforward translation that we're going to read to. right here. Jeremiah 17, this isn't the one I'm talking about, but Jeremiah 17, 3 through 5. O my mountain in the field, I will give thy substance and all thy treasures to the spoil, and thy high places for sin throughout all thy borders. And thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee. And I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in a land which thou knowest not, for ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. So right here, we see a prophecy of Israel discontinuing from their heritage. We have seen prophecies of Israel forgetting God if they don't follow his commandments. We see Chronicles and Kings referring to them remembering themselves or bethinking themselves. But this discontinuance from their heritage, how would they forget? How would they discontinue from their heritage? And so let me bring you back to history. Blacks, Jews, the religious challenge, the source that I've recently been accused of deleting for some reason, even though I have this in so many different videos, but I'll have a link to this source so you guys can grab it for yourself. But Blacks, Jews, the religious challenge, Cambridge University, Ulysses S. Santa Maria. Many of us are familiar with it. I'm going to read this part right here. This middle paragraph on page, what page is this? Page 230 is where it's going to show on the bottom, but over here it's going to be page 15 out of 25. When he arrived, the Negro was firstly deprived of his name, separated from his family and the others of his tribe. This is systematic, and this is important why we're reading this, because when we get to Psalms, I'm going to come back to this. The anonymity of servitude, the dispersion and rapid rotation of workers atomized them to such an extent that they became absolutely alienated objects. No social reference existed among these herds of slaves. They became social aliens, tallyable and workable at pleasure. In the 18th century, some Europeans began to talk of genocide or wiping out Israel. This is important because this coincides with Psalms 83. They could not wipe out Israel. There was another plan in place. Israel had to forget who they were. God was not going to let the enemy wipe out Israel. He said he'd leave a remnant. It says in England, it was the warnings of the religious groups such as the Quakers and Methodists. Didn't we read about the Quakers in the Awakening? Which produced the anti-slave movement. In 1834, all the slaves of the British Empire were freed. It was not until 1865 that the law for abolition of slavery in the USA was voted in. So they were talking of genocide, and it was the religious leaders during this awakening period that talked them out of genociding all of these people. Again, I don't know what these people found or were saying, or if they just came to the conclusion that, hey, what we did wasn't right. We stole people, which we've learned about. When you steal a man, according to the Bible, the punishment was death. It was forbidden to steal someone and sell them into slavery, which is what the Europeans did. This is just historical fact. So we see that they are stripped of their identity. They are stripped of any relations. They have no social reference, according to this document. So let's keep going. They have no social reference. This is going to become very important in a second. Let me move this over here. So let's continue with Baruch. Baruch was removed from the Bible. As you see on my BibleStudyTools.com, you can find the book of Baruch pretty much on all Bible study sites, including BlackHistoryInTheBible.com. If we come over here to the sidebar, we got the book of Maccabees. I'm sorry, the Apocrypha right here, but we do got the book of Maccabees. But you see Baruch right here. Baruch is here in its entirety. We have the book of Maccabees as well. If you click Baruch over here, it will take you to Baruch chapter 1, and you can read it in the KJV. And if you click any of these links, it will take you to all the information we have on Egypt or prophets or righteousness. So anyway, the book of Baruch, you guys can read that. It's in the Septuagint. It does not appear in the King James Bible, but it does appear in the Catholic Bible, as well as, I believe, the Ethiopian Coptic Bible, if I'm not mistaken. And it is considered part of the Apocrypha, or the hidden books. And we'll read right here. We'll start at verse 27, and we'll go to verse 33. It says, O Lord, our God, thou hast dealt with us after all thy goodness and according to all that great mercy of thine. As thou speakest by thy servant Moses in the day when thou didst command him to write the law before the children of Israel, saying, so remember, Baruch is Jeremiah's scribe, and he's referring back to Moses. Deuteronomy, where we keep referencing back to. This is why I say it's foundational. Everybody keeps referring back to Deuteronomy. Christ refers to Deuteronomy in Luke and in Revelation when he's given the vision to John. Go back and watch my previous video, part 12, for that. As thou spakest by thy servant Moses in the day when thou didst command him to write the law before the children of Israel, saying, if ye will not hear my voice, surely this great multitude shall be turned into a small number among the nations where I will scatter them. That's directly from Deuteronomy 28. For I knew that they would not hear me, because it is a stiff-necked people. But in the land of their captivities, more than one, they shall remember themselves. So this is going to be a recurring thing. And so people will say, well, this has been fulfilled. Well, it doesn't look like it. Go back and watch the rest of the series. I talked about how this happened over and over and over again through Israel's history, but none of them matched the last day's event that was talked about in Israel's history. And shall know that I am the Lord their God, for I will give them a heart and ears to hear, and they shall praise me in the land of their captivity and think upon my name and return from their stiff neck and from their wicked deeds, for they shall remember the way of their fathers which sinned before the Lord. So this, all this calling to mind, this remembering God, remembering themselves, this links back to Deuteronomy chapter 28 and the covenant, the Moabite covenant. Let's keep going. Psalms. Psalms 83, and we're going to look at, we call this the Psalms 83 conspiracy. This is the plot by multiple nations to make Israel forget. People will say that this is to wipe out Israel, but as we have seen, Israel will not be exterminated according to the Bible. We saw that during, we'll come back and read that source one more time, but when they started, the Europeans started to talk of genocide of the slaves, there were Europeans that stood up and said, no, you can't wipe them out. A song or psalm of Asaph. Keep not thou silence, O God. Hold not thy peace and be not still, O God. Kumbaya, arise, Father God. For lo, and people can doubt Kumbaya all they want to. See, what they'll do is they'll do a surface search or a surface bit of research, and they'll find something they agree with and say, oh, well, that's not it. But they don't dig deeper. I did this study on Kumbaya a long time ago. And if you guys go to blackhistoryinthebible.com and you look at the Kumbaya article, I actually have people in Gullah in the article, people who speak Gullah, talking about some of the stuff. So when people who do not speak Gullah come by and tell people who do speak Gullah, I don't speak Gullah, but the people on the article I shared, the people in the videos I shared, they speak Gullah and they come from the Gullah culture. When you have people who do not speak Gullah trying to correct people who come from the culture on their own culture, that sounds crazy. So when people say, well, Kumbaya don't mean that, they're lying. And I don't care what they say. They got to show me the research. They got to pull up all of their research and prove to us it doesn't mean that. And they'll say, well, the burden of proof is on you. Well, the Gullah people said it, and that's their culture. So, no, you're making a claim, too. So when you come by and make the claim, that's not what it means. Then you have to prove your point. The burden of proof is on you to make your claim. So until I see otherwise, saying it doesn't mean that does not make it true. I need to see the evidence that it means something else. What does that word Yah mean? Why are the words Kum, Ba, and Yah? Why are those all Hebrew words? They want to pretend like this is all one word. No, it's Kum, Ba, Yah. Three different words, or technically a phrase. They want to say that doesn't mean what we think it means. Black don't mean black. Yah don't mean Yah. This is really not what it means. Gullah, even though it's Hebrew, that's just a coincidence. Gullah is a mixture of Creole, a Creole and Patois and West African languages. But as we read from this source right here, hold on, let me go back over there. Let's talk about Gullah real quick. Let me see. Oh, wait. Let's see the word Arab. Right here. In southern Nigeria, the natives call the black Jews the strange people in the Imo Yokwaim. They are called the Bani Ephraim, the sons of Ephraim. They claim that their ancestors came from Morocco, so North Africa, and this is supported by Godby. I showed his map, who noted that their language is a mixture of Maghrebian Arab, ancient Hebrew, and local Patois. For example, Abu, meaning father, became Yaba. For mother is close to the Hebrew word. These Imo Yokwaim Jews live in the Ondo district and have a copy of the Torah. So in southern Nigeria, and some of you have seen my 23andMe journey, I am 48% Nigerian, and my lineage links back directly to the Igbo. And this is talking about the Igbo language and how similar it is to Hebrew. So how is it coincidence that people who were in Africa were speaking a mixture of Maghrebian Arab, ancient Hebrew, and local Patois? They come over here, their ancestors speak Gullah. Gullah is a Hebrew word. Let me show y'all real quick. Let me move this over here. Oh, we about to get into some stuff real quick. Let's see. Meaning of Gullah in Hebrew. Gullah, the Gullah language is a mixture of languages, so the Hebrew word for bowl or basin is fitting. This is on medium.com, 1900s. So anyway, since those are typically used for mixing things together, let's keep going. Strong's 1353, Gullah, right there. It's directly from the Strong's. Gullah, pronounced Geula, feminine passive participle. Let's just click this and see. BibleTools.org. This ain't an Israelite thing right here. Let me close this. BibleTools.com. Let me move this out of my way. Greek Hebrew definitions. Gullah, pronounced Geula, feminine passive participle of 1350. Redemption, including the right and the object by implication, relationship, kindred, redeem, redemption, right. Brown Driver Briggs, Geula, kindred, redemption, right of redemption, price of redemption, kin, kindred, redemption, right of redemption, price of redemption, redemption price. Usage 14 times. So the word Gullah is used in the Bible 14 times. Redemption, redeem, then he may redeem. So all throughout the law, Gullah is used. In Ruth, Gullah is used. Jeremiah, Gullah is used. Ezekiel, Gullah is used. But people want us to believe that this word or this phrase kumbaya, which is saying in Gullah, which we see clearly is a Hebrew word, has nothing to do with the Yah of the Bible. Everything is coincidence. These people had the Torah. They were taken from West Africa. They were practicing Judaism. They were descendants of Israelites from that migrated into North Africa, Morocco and other parts, and then down into Central Africa, and then later on to West Africa. And then some were deported from Portugal and brought to the West African coast and the islands of Sao Tome and Principe. They want us to believe that all this stuff is coincidence. And then they got over here and sang Kumbaya, and it has no relation to Hebrew. This right here is the faulty research affecting the black community. They want to take a half but approach to research, and they aren't honest about all of the stuff going on in the Bible. So let's continue. So the plan was to wipe out the memory of them. And again, we defer back to Psalms 83. So when we come back over here, when he arrived, the Negro was firstly deprived of his name, separated from his family and others of the tribe. The anonymity of servitude and the dispersion and rapid rotation of workers atomized them to such an extent that they became absolutely alienated objects. No social reference existed among these herds of slaves. They became social aliens, tallyable and workable at pleasure. In the 18th century, some Europeans began to talk of genocide. In England, it was the warnings of the religious groups, such as the Quakers, Methodists, which produced the anti-slave movement. In 1834, all the slaves of the British Empire were freed. It was not until 1865 that the law for the abolition of slavery in the USA was voted in. So, again, they have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. Or that it may be no more remembered. Let us cut them off, that it be no more remembered. Let's look at this word remember. Remember, remember, are not mentioned, no mention, may be no more in remembrance. That's Psalm 83. Remembered. So we see the context of this word is remember. Let me come over here. So they wanted the remembrance, bring to mind, call to mind, so that the name of Israel is no more called to mind or remembered. Let us cut them off from being a nation. That was a plot in the Bible. Let us cut them off from being a nation. When in Israel's history did they cease to be a nation before the transatlantic slave trade? If you do not believe that the transatlantic slave trade was part of Bible prophecy, the biggest slavery event in history, to one of the most powerful nations in history. They want to say this has no biblical significance. God is just going to talk about every slavery before that one. It gets to that one, and then suddenly, Bible prophecy's over. It's all been fulfilled. Nothing else to see here. Even though the Bible talks of a people that want to cut Israel off from being a nation, even though we've seen over and over again that they were going to forget their God, they were going to forget themselves, but in the land of their captivities they shall remember themselves, they will bethink themselves, they will call it to mind. Let's keep going. So we see that Gullah is Hebrew, Kumbaya, all of that stuff. Now let's come to Ezekiel. Let's read chapter 6 verses 7 through 10, and I'll have the link again to that Cambridge source for you guys. That was the same source for the Igbo stuff that I just went over, all of that. And the slain shall fall in the midst of you, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. Yet will I leave a remnant, meaning no genocide, that ye may have some that shall escape the sword among the nations when ye shall be scattered through the countries, and they that escape of you shall remember me among the nations whither they shall be carried captives. Why would they forget their God? Because I am broken with their whorish heart, which hath departed from me, and with their eyes, which go a-whoring after their idols. And they shall loathe themselves for the evils which they have committed in all their abominations. And they shall know that I am the Lord, and that I have not said in vain that I would do this evil unto them. This is what the awakening is all about. Us remembering what our ancestors did to bring this evil upon us. And they want us to accept the explanation. Well, slavery was just people being people. No, this was different. This was targeted. This was intentional. How do we know it was targeted and intentional? I'll show you. All right, here we go. Back to the same Cambridge source. Right there where I said they have a copy of the Torah, we're going to pick up the next paragraph. The study of customs and rites and analysis of the semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to purpose some hypotheses and even draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godby reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. So more likely. It is virtually certain, not a guess, not probably, it is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How many would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. This conclusion put forth by Godby, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse, but most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated Black Americans as a key argument. Educated Black Americans, they like to say we're stupid, and even though many of us have degrees and come from all kind of different backgrounds, computers and everything else, they like to say we're stupid and we don't understand, we're not educated. Even though Cambridge is saying it's been adopted by a class of educated Black Americans as the key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. So wait a minute. we know that they were choosing a certain type of people based on this. And so let's come over here to blackhistorythebible.com. Let's go back to the home page because there is something I want to show you guys. Let me go down here. We're going to find the Sabians. Let's come down here. I moved the Sabians like I said I was going to do right here. Sabians. We're going to come over here to the Sabians. And we're going to pull up some information on the Sabians. Let's see. Not sure why it wasn't working. But yeah, I'm going to let that load and I'm going to come back for a second. Not sure why everything is not clicking right. Give me 1 second here. All right, here we go. Not sure what the holdup on that was. All right, so right here, I read this before to you guys, the 600 families of the Sabians. We'll come over here, the Atlas Geographus. And remember what I just read right here. Adopted by a class of educated Black Americans is the key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. Now here's the source that I showed you guys before from 1714. And if we come over here, 1714 is page 38 and 39, as you can see, and we come over here, we read on this side of the page, it says, Leo says, there are other kingdoms on the south frontier of this country, he's talking about Africa, which are inhabited by a rich, industrious, and just sort of people. Judaism was the religion of the ancient Africans for a long time and succeeded by Christianity, but Mahometanism prevailed in the 208th year of the Hegira, when all the Jews, Christians, and proselytes of the African religion that could be found were put to death. So we have a source from 1714 that tells us this. I'll have this link in the description for you guys. So Atlas Geographus, again, 1714. So it corroborates what it's saying right here, is that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery. So they that escape you shall remember among the nations whether you are carried away captives. So people forgot or were made to forget. Let's go to Zechariah. Zechariah 10:8, and I believe this is the point we have entered into right now. We'll just read verses 8 through 12. I believe we're near this point right now. Again, it may not be spot on. I believe we're near it. Not a prophecy, just saying we're near it. Because people like to twist your words and say, oh, you're making a prophecy. I've never declared myself a prophet. Never said, thus saith the Lord, or God told me, or God gave me a message, or the Spirit told me to tell you. That's nothing I've ever done. This notion of me prophesying and making prophecies is completely false. They have fabricated themselves when you hear people say this. So, again, my opinion that we are at this point. I will hiss for them and gather them, for I have redeemed them, and they shall increase as they have increased, and I will sow them among the people, and they shall remember me in far countries, and they shall live with their children and turn again. So wait a minute, why is that significant? Because they were separated from their children during these slaveries, but more specifically the transatlantic slave trade, not in every slave trade, but specifically the transatlantic slave trade. We just read twice that they were separated. They were atomized so that they could be workable and pliable. They had no social reference. The families were split apart. They discontinued from their heritage, but they sang Kumbaya. And again, if anybody is running with the Kumbaya don't mean that, have them explain why Gullah is Hebrew and why Gullah appears in the Bible. Explain why they have a West African culture and the dialect comes from Gullah. West African dialect is considered part of Gullah. So matter of fact, hold on, let me just pull it up. All right, we're just gonna look at Wikipedia real quick for this, and you guys can go deeper into this if you want to. I already showed you that Gullah is Hebrew. I proved it to you. I pulled up the Strong's. I showed you guys from a unbiased source that has no dog in this fight that Gullah is indeed a Hebrew or part of the Hebrew language. Gullah, also called Gullah English, Sea Island Creole English, and Geechee, is a Creole language spoken by the Gullah people, also called Geechies, within the community, an African-American population living in the coastal regions of South Carolina and Georgia, including urban Charleston and Savannah, as well as extreme northeastern Florida and the extreme southeast of North Carolina. My grandmother, not my grandfather, but my grandmother used to say these little sayings that I later found out were similar to things they would say in Gullah. I'm not going to get into all that right now. Right here. Carolina speaking Gullah in English. I feature her.
My name is Carolyn. I'm one of Charleston.
Let me turn that down on my end so y'all don't hear the echo. But I feature this lady on my study in Gullah. I feature her talking and speaking Gullah and teaching the Gullah history.
Since Gullah Stokra, and Gullah means the white plantation owner. And Shum over there. May I say, girl, you ain't Shum over there? You ain't Shum there? Shum there means to see. See it over there. Shum there.
Rewind it a little bit.
Shum was the owner of the place, you see. And mad him would be in the feeling. You ain't know say Buckra do so and so. Man, Buckra but too mean. But if he was by the gate, he ain't know who he talking about. Talking about him. Yeah. So remember that Buckra in Gullah means the white plantation owner. And Shum over there. May I say, girl, you ain't Shum over there? You ain't Shum there? Shum there means to see. See it over there, Shum there. Shum there means not just to see, you know, it's an object, something you see, the word Shum. And what another, yum there, see him there, you know, yum, him there, him there. You know, and the people, old people talk.
All right, so y'all hear her speaking a little bit of Gullah. Y'all can go dig into that a little bit on your own if you want to. So right here, the origins, just want to read this real quick. Gullah is based on different varieties of English and languages of Central Africa and West Africa. Scholars have proposed a number of theories about the origins of Gullah and its development. Gullah developed independently on the sea islands off the coast of Carolinas, Georgia, Florida throughout the 18th and 19th centuries by enslaved Africans. They developed a language that combined grammatical, phonological, and lexical features of the non-standard English variety spoken by that region's white slaveholders and farmers in that region, along with those from numerous Western and Central African languages. According to this view, Gullah developed separately or distinctly from African American vernacular English and varieties of English spoken in the South. We can keep going on through this, but you will find that Gullah is an official language. Gullah people have several words of Niger, Congo, and Bantu origin in their languages, or in their language, that have survived to the present day despite over 400 years. How does that keep coming up? Of slavery when African Americans were forced to speak English. I mean, we can read through all this. The vocabulary of Gullah comes primarily from English, but there are numerous Africanisms that exist in their language for which scholars have yet to produce detailed etymologies. Some of the African loanwords includes kuta or turtle, una, you, nyam. You guys can go through all of this. I'm not going to butcher the whole language. Or bene, sesame. Linguists notice that Gullah Geechee people's language has about 25% of the words from Sierra Leone, a country in West Africa. You guys can go through and see my DNA journey, and I talk a little bit about Sierra Leone. Also, songs sung in Gullah Geechee Nation was traced to the Mendes people, the ethnic group in Sierra Leone. And I get into the Israelite presence in Sierra Leone and Nigeria and all that stuff. So we see that there is a connection here. People want to act like all this stuff is coincidence. None of this has nothing to do with nothing. Nothing to see here. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. We're going to wrap this up in a second. Jeremiah chapter 23. We'll come back to Jeremiah real quick. This is why I think it's important to understand Bible prophecy. Let me just start reading verse 17. Jeremiah 23, verse 17 through 20. They say still unto them that despise me, the Lord hath said, ye shall have peace. And they say unto everyone that walketh after the imagination of his own heart, no evil shall come upon you. Do what you want. Do as thou wilt. Bring that Christmas tree into your house. Celebrate that bunny. Wear those costumes. I know the Bible said, don't do this, but we have liberty in Christ to do this anyway. They're walking after the imaginations of their own hearts. They're using their liberty as an occasion to sin. What is sin? Sin is transgression of the law. Which law? The law of Christ or the law of Moses? They will have you believe that they are two different things. But when Christ was asked which are the greatest of the laws, he was being asked about the laws of Moses. He wasn't being asked to create two new laws. He was being asked about the laws of Moses. Yeah, I know. We're going to wiggle the law in on them. So let's see. For who hath stood in the counsel of the Lord and hath perceived and heard his word? Who hath marked his word and heard it? Behold, a whirlwind of the Lord is gone forth in fury, even a grievous whirlwind. It shall fall grievously upon the head of the wicked. The anger of the Lord shall not return until he have executed, until he have performed the thoughts of his heart. In the latter days, ye shall consider it perfectly. We've gone over these latter days comments in more detail previously. So I'm not going to get, you know, all off into the latter days once again, because you guys, again, go through the Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series, parts 1 through 12, and you guys can hear me talk more about that. But these things are going to come to mind in the latter days. And once again, Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 17 through 20. And then here in Jeremiah 30, I'll just read verses 20 through 24. Their children also shall be as aforetime, and their congregation shall be established before me, and I will punish all that oppress them, everybody that oppresses Israel. And for reminder, let's look up the definition of oppression so nobody's confused. I forgot the P. The definition of oppression: prolonged, cruel, or unjust treatment or control, the state of being subject to unjust treatment or control, mental pressure, or distress. It says nothing about your paycheck, your cars, or your houses. So when you hear people getting on with that narrative that they're not oppressed because they have that stuff, they clearly need to read a dictionary. So now, God is going to punish all that oppress Israel, everybody, including, I believe, people who identify themselves as Christians and still want to oppress Israel and boast against the natural branches. And their nobles shall be themselves. I went over this. And their governor shall proceed from the midst of them, and I will cause him to draw near, and he shall approach unto me. For who is this that engaged his heart to approach unto me, saith the Lord? So who engaged their heart to approach unto him? The Lord is going to do this. I will cause him to draw near, and he shall approach unto me. For who is this that engaged his heart to approach unto me, saith the Lord? And ye shall be my people, and I will be your God. Behold, the whirlwind of the Lord goeth forth with fury, a continuing whirlwind. It shall fall with pain upon the head of the wicked. The fierce anger of the Lord shall not return until he have done it, and until he have performed the intents of his heart. In the latter days, the last days, ye shall consider it. So again, this reference to the latter days. And we're going to wrap this up. Why is this important? This forgetting of God, this forgetting of themselves, the not keeping of the commandments, the discontinuing from their heritage, all the links to Africa, this awakening that seems to be a ongoing theme in American history. Why is it such a big deal now with us? And I believe it's because things are coming to a head. And we can read in Revelation. Hold on. Before we go to Revelation, I want to go to Romans. And before I wrap this up with Revelation, it talks about the wild olive tree, the grafting in. It says, "For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles come in." So is this talking about spiritual blindness only? Or is it talking about something deeper than just spiritual blindness to who the Messiah is? Because some Israelites did believe in the Messiah. Not all of Israel rejected the Messiah, because Paul and the original Christians were Israelites. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, "There shall come out of Zion the deliverer." Deliverer. What is he delivering them from? "And shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins." Wait a minute. There's a covenant for this? We're not going to get into that right now, but that's a whole nother study. "For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. We're not getting all that. But anyway, blindness, a partial blindness, has happened to Israel. And again, this is important because I believe we're coming to a series of events. I don't believe all of them have happened. I believe they are coming. And we see in Revelation, there's something interesting that happens. This right here wants to put the emphasis on Michael, the archangel fighting Satan. But we'll read verses 8 through 18 right here. And I'm not saying this has happened already, but I believe it's coming to this. And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. I'm a pause right here, because this is important. This is the verse that links the dragon, the serpent in the garden, the devil, and Satan as all one being. People try to say that these are not the same being, but Revelation 12:9 says the dragon, the old serpent, it gives you all the titles, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He's deceived the whole world. And yet some people think that what we call the Christian church, the buildings, the seminaries, the doctrine has not been tampered with. People will say they teach the apostles' doctrine, but I've found something very interesting, that there are some Europeans that claim they teach the apostles' doctrine, and their doctrine is different from some of these people in the black church that say they teach the apostles' doctrine. Where in the apostles' doctrine does it say you have to go to seminary? Anybody's welcome to answer that. Press a 1 if the apostles' doctrine teaches that you need to go to seminary. Press a 2 if you do not see that in the Bible, that it teaches that you need to go to seminary. Press a 1 if the Bible says that you need to get a certificate of ordination, and press 2 if it doesn't. I know I asked y'all some stuff real quick. Press 1 if you, let me start. Yeah, press 1 if you don't see seminary in the Bible. Did I say that right? Let me start over. All right, scratch all the stuff y'all done pressed. We're going to start over. Press a 1 if the apostles' doctrine says you need to go to seminary. Press a 2 if the apostles' doctrine does not say you need to go to seminary. Press a 3 if the apostles' doctrine say you need to be ordained. Press a 4. I'm talking about get a certificate of ordination. So press 3 if the apostles' doctrine say you need a certificate of ordination. Press a 4 if the apostles' doctrine does not say you need a certificate of ordination. Press a 5 if the apostles' doctrine say you need to be locked in to a church home. Or press a 6 if you know that the Bible says where 2 or 3 are gathered together in my name. There I will be in the midst of them. I know y'all gotta press a lot of numbers there. I assume y'all should be pressing 2, 4, and 6 right now if y'all paying attention. All right. And I heard the voice. Well, let me go back. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, come in, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Sounds like some people we have run into. They all they do is accuse people. They listen to make accusations, false accusations at that. And that's the craziness. They make false accusations because they hate. It's hate in their heart. I ain't even gonna say his name, but the brother gonna say I was clout chasing because I said that everybody's welcomed on my channel that has been. And no, it was not Berean that said it. I'm not talking about Berean right now. Somebody else in Berean's chat said it. But in an effort to keep some decorum, I'm not going to say their name. But they said that I was clout chasing because I invited people in that were hurt by the church. Not sure how I can clout chase off of my own page, but, you know, lies like that, deception like that. You will see that those opinions come up because they hate black people. And it's no other explanation for it. Hate. How do you hate someone you've never met, you don't know nothing about, you just, you know, formed your own opinion because you don't like the fact that I claim I'm Israel? And that's part of the deception being pushed. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. See, amillennialism can't comprehend some of these things, so they try to spiritualize them away so it makes sense to them. There's no way the devil will come down and Christ is actually going to return. They don't believe the Bible. I really don't believe amillennialists believe Bible prophecy, my opinion. And when the dragon saw that he was cast into the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child, Israel. The man-child is not Israel. The man-child is Christ. But the woman that brought forth Christ was Israel. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. Why is that important? Hold on. Before I tell you why that's important, let me just read down to the bottom. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time and times and a half a time from the face of the serpent. So this woman is given wings of an eagle, and that she might fly into the wilderness. All right, I had to pull up a couple of verses real quick. And again, this is why I tell you, the book of Revelation, you have to understand the Old Testament to really get into some of the nuances in the book of Revelation. Otherwise, you won't understand it. And to me, the amillennialist position strips the message of a lot of the Bible by trying to replace things and reinterpret things. So this woman, who I believe is Israel, because the sun, the moon, the stars, that's directly linked to the dream of Joseph in Genesis. She's given wings of a great eagle. What is that a reference to? People talk about, where's this Exodus, this second Exodus? This is a direct reference to the Exodus. Now remember, this vision is given to John by Christ. He's in the spirit on the Lord's day, or the day of the Lord, as I said. So Christ, who has made references to the Old Testament, the books of Moses before, in Luke 21 in the Olivet Discourse, where he talks about the sword and worldwide slavery, it shows us a direct reference to Deuteronomy 28. I showed you guys in the last part that Christ makes direct references in the book of Revelation once again to the sword. He that kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. He that leads into captivity must go into captivity. This is a reference to Deuteronomy, I believe chapter 30 or 31. I believe it's chapter 30, where the curses are reversed and put on Israel's enemies. So once again, here we have Christ referencing the book of Moses. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. This occurs in Exodus chapter 19. Moses on Sinai. We'll read verses 1 through 6. In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai. For they were departed from Rephidim and were come to the desert of Sinai and had pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before the mount. And Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thou shalt say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. So he bare them on eagle's wings. He brought them out to the wilderness to himself. Remember the message that Moses was giving Pharaoh? Let us go out to the wilderness to worship our God. This is what he requires. And Pharaoh said no. And Moses said that God said, let my people go. So he bears them on eagle's wings and brought them to himself. Where? In the wilderness. So we see in Revelation, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. So we see an Exodus reference right here, that she might fly into the wilderness. This is what happened in Exodus. He bare them on eagle's wings. They went into the wilderness. They had a purge event where the rebels were purged out, including Moses for what he did. And then the remnant that were left over after that, through the leadership of Joshua, they went into the land. This is a blueprint. I said this before. The Exodus is a blueprint. The books of Moses, why they call Moses a prophet, it's a blueprint. Where else? By the mouth of two or three witnesses shall a matter be established. So we see the Exodus event is talking about eagle's wings, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place where she is nourished for a time, a times and a half, from the face of the serpent. Hold on. Is there a reference to somebody coming into the wilderness in the last days? Right here, God will restore Israel to her land. This is in Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 33 through 38. We'll read down to 38. As I live, this is a promise, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out will I rule over you, and I will bring you out from the people. Sound like an Exodus to me, but this is something prophesied to come, and will gather you out of the countries wherein ye are scattered with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. We're talking about the book of Revelation. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face. Has this happened yet? Anybody that says this has been fulfilled, ask them when in history did this happen? Like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, saith the Lord God. Face to face, the fiery furnace tower, the flame of fire, or the pillar of fire and the pillar of smoke. He will plead with them face to face. The same thing that happened in Abraham's dream in Genesis 15, where he promised the land, and he promised the 400 years of captivity, and he had a pillar of fire and smoke. Then when he brought him out of Egypt, he had a pillar of fire and smoke, and he's saying he's going to bring them into the wilderness so that he could plead with them face to face. In Revelation, we see that the woman is bore on eagle's wings, that she might fly into the wilderness. So now, I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face, like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so will I plead with you, saith the Lord, and I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant, and I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgress against me, and I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. This is the second Exodus event being described in Ezekiel. So when we go back to Revelation and we see Christ telling John to write this, and we see him talk about the woman, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, reference directly to the Exodus, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place where she is nourished for a time, a times and a half a time, from the face of the serpent. We see that Ezekiel tells that there's going to be a time where Israel is pulled out of the countries and brought back to the wilderness, where God is going to deal with the rebels, and the rebels that transgress against him will not enter into the land. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood, or he wants to get rid of this woman. He's mad at the woman that brought forth the man child. Why? Because the man child means his destruction. And so he's mad at Israel. And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth. Isn't that similar to what happened to the Egyptians that came after Israel and during the Exodus? They were swallowed up in the water. But now the flood is swallowed up by the earth that the dragon cast out of his mouth. And some people will say, well, the waters are symbolic for people or nations that would go after Israel. But here's the part. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Why is that? Why is he making war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ? See, something is off about what we've been being taught. Why is he not just mad at the people who have the testimony of Christ? Or why is he not just mad at the people that keep the commandments but don't have the testimony of Christ? He is specifically mad at a specific group of people that descend from this woman and keep the commandments of God, and they have the testimony of Christ. See, I believe we are, the awakening is leading up to this wilderness experience. And I believe we are not far from the part right here that Christ talks about in Revelation, where the woman is given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place where she's nourished for a time, a times and a half a time. I don't believe we're too far from Ezekiel when the Most High says he's going to, that he, well, Exodus, again, that reference to Exodus in the Old Testament, but Ezekiel, where he says, I will bring you to the wilderness of the people, and there I will plead with you face to face, like as I pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so I will plead with you, saith the Lord God, and I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant, and I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgress against me. I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. This is why I'm not worried about all the doctrines in Israel. This is why I'm not worried when we have people from different walks of life awakening and saying, I'm Israel. I received a vision. I'm Israel. I had a dream and God told me to open the book. I prayed and I was told that I'm Israel. I studied the history and I found out I'm Israel. I studied the DNA and I found out I'm Israel. My parents passed down for generations the fact that we are Israel. Even though that there are all manner of doctrines floating around Israel, the Most High has promised that he will bring the people of Israel into the wilderness, and he will purge from among us the rebels. So everybody caught up in doctrine and trying to label everybody heretics and wanting us to speak up against people's doctrine, it's not even necessary. The Most High says he will purge the rebels from among us. And if anybody says that has been fulfilled, tell them to show you what point in history it has been fulfilled, because I find that a lot of people who inhabit those buildings, the church buildings, they like to tell you things were fulfilled, but they don't have the historical receipts to back their belief. They want you to take it on faith that they're right. Just like the Gullah thing. They want us to believe that these Israelites all were gathered in West Africa. Then none of them got on slave ships. They were, unless they were hitchhiking. Then the people came over here singing in Gullah, singing Kumbaya, even though we could find every bit of that phrase in Hebrew from a language that appears in Hebrew, Gullah. They want us to believe it has no connection to Israel or Hebrew. It doesn't make sense, and they don't have the receipts to back it. Anyone telling you that, you know, all this stuff is not connected is teaching falsely. So hopefully, if you guys like this, press one. If you guys enjoyed this, press one. If you did not enjoy this, press two. If you are enjoying the full Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series, press three. And if you are not enjoying the full series, please press four. Go ahead and be honest. Now, if you guys don't know the Messiah, I would encourage you to get to know the Messiah, Yahawashi, Yahuwah, Yeshua, all the other names, Jesus, the Christ. Whether you say it in English or Swahili or any other language, he is not bound by language. The fact that the letter J didn't exist doesn't matter. God is all knowing. If you don't believe God is all knowing, and if you don't believe God can, if you believe the letter J is a stumbling stone for God, then the God you're following is not the God of the Bible, and you need to get to know the God of the Bible and his Messiah. There are promises made for Israel, and God is not a liar. God is not a breaker of his promises. God fully intends to keep his promises. He didn't transfer them over to some other people and say, look, remember those things I promised you? Well, now they don't apply to you. I'm giving them to other people, but I'm still going to say I fulfilled them. That's not how God works. That's how man's logic works. So anyway, if you guys don't know the Messiah, it's time to get to know the Messiah. Time is short. We've been told, even when I was more active in the Christian church, they would say that we are living in the last days. And if that is the case, then as Christ said, during the last days, Israel would be scattered into all nations via slavery. We see that event, even though people don't want to accept that there was a worldwide slavery that happened. I believe it's because they don't believe the Bible. And two, they hate black people. They hate black people making the claim because they know there's some accountability to come. If we are the people of the book, as we're saying, they know good and well there's accountability to God. There is a price to be paid. Read Joel 3 in its entirety. Read the book of Revelation in its entirety. Read the whole Bible in its entirety, but more specifically Joel 3 and the book of Revelation, if you want to understand that debt to be paid that is coming to the nations. God is going to punish all that oppressed Israel, all that enslaved Israel. He says he's going to make a full end of the nations, but he's not going to make a full end of Israel. So make sure you guys hit the thumbs up if you haven't done so already. That's super important. See, real quick, the more engagement YouTube sees on a video, the more they promote that video. So when you guys hit the thumbs up, when you share it, when you hit the ones, twos, threes, fours, fives, and sixes in the chat, that increases the engagement on the video, and the video gets shared to more people. And then of course, if you share the video and more people share the video and they see it, it spreads this information around. It's time to you know, press hard and continue to wake up our people. I don't advocate for walking away from the body of Christ. I advocate for walking away from the buildings. I advocate for walking away from spiritual indoctrination, and I advocate walking away from the cult-like behavior we see in the church buildings. I do not tell people to walk away from the body of Christ. You can assemble in other places. You do not have to assemble at any one church congregation. You don't have to join there. You don't have to be a member. You don't have to put your name on the church roll. You can assemble with other believers. This is the body of Christ, not the body of fill-in-the-blank preacher, pastor, or bishop. This is the body of Christ, and you can congregate and assemble with other believers. And as I said before, everybody is welcomed here. You may not be welcome to teach your doctrine or your lifestyle if it's some kind of crazy lifestyle, but you are welcome to sit, listen, ask questions, participate, and fellowship. And again, just because you're sitting, listening, and participating does not mean you will be allowed to be disruptive or push contrary doctrines to what is taught on this channel. If you want to teach your doctrine, please, by all means, go to another channel that allows that. But the moderators are on point here. They don't allow certain things, but everybody is welcome. So again, hit that thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe if you haven't done so already, and hit the share button. With that said, till next time, I'm out.